Lecture one on biological membranes. In the series of lectures that we'll be taking. So this is the usual disclaimer that it is meant for you, especially for the students of different branches of life sciences affected by lockdown, and it should not be used for any other purpose, copied or posted on any site without the permission of the author, that is me. And some of the pictures in the presentation may have been taken from public domain websites. Okay, so as to just to make the concepts clear, because credit for such pictures remain with the original publisher. All right, so what are biological membranes? Let us understand that first. As I said, our primary aim is to make our concepts clear. So bookish definition for them is that they are organized sheet-like structures. Sheet, the way you have paper sheet, is something like that. They are organized structures, sheet-like structures, and they are made up of two primary components. They are made up of proteins and lipids mainly. Okay, there are two major components in it: lipids and proteins. Right. And what do? They provide individuality to the cell. You know, they demarcate the boundary of individual cell. So they provide individuality to a cell by separating its internal environment from external environment. Okay, so they provide individuality to cell means this becomes one cell. This becomes second cell, right? This becomes third cell. So what do? They serve as a partition between the extracellular environment. This is extracellular environment, and this is intracellular environment. So they serve as a partition between the two, and that is how they provide individuality to a cell. So your body is made up of different types of cells, a group of cells, a specialized cell, you call it as tissue, all right? So all cells, they are separated from their extracellular environment with the help of this biological membrane. Now in eukaryotes, in higher organisms like you and me, besides the cell membrane, within the cell also you have organelles, and the boundaries of those organelles is also made up of biological membrane. So you have mitochondria within the cell, so you have mitochondria here, all right? So this mitochondria boundary is also made up of biological membrane. So you have Golgi apparatus, you have nucleus, you have peroxisomes, and so many other cellular organelles are there. So their boundaries are also made up of these biological membranes. Means the membranes of these organelles are similar structurally as well as functionally to that of the membrane of the cell, the plasma membrane, right? So those membranes are same, identical. So these are biological membranes. So if you have to define biological membranes, what are they? So you can put these three points, that this is what is meant by biological membranes. The next question that comes is, what are their functions? What do they do? So please remember that these biological membranes, they function as a highly selective permeability barrier. Because of their presence, not anything and everything can pass through, can get in and out of the cell. That means they are acting as a highly selective biological membranes. So movement of compounds, metabolites, ions, polar, non-polar species is strictly regulated because of their presence. So they act as what is termed as technically highly selective permeability membrane, permeability barrier. They contain channels and pumps. Okay, so not anything and everything can pass through these membranes easily, radially. For the transport of those molecules which cannot pass through these membranes easily, on the membranes you have channels, specific channels, and you have pumps, right? So those compounds, those metabolites, those species which cannot pass through these membranes radially can be transported across with the help of either channels or pumps which are located on the membrane. And what do? These channels and pumps together, they help regulate the ionic and molecular composition of the intracellular medium. Okay, because of their presence and because of their ability to transport some of the selective metabolites, they help regulate the ionic and molecular composition of the intracellular medium, means within the cell. If this is the cell, right? So this intracellular environment, it is regulated. Ionic and molecular composition of the intracellular environment is regulated because of the presence of channels and pumps and because of the selective transport of species through them. In addition to this, which is the major function, what do? The membranes, they control flow of information between cell and the environment. You know, cell can communicate with its neighboring cell as well as cell can communicate with its extracellular environment also. And here again, these membranes, they play an important role. They control the flow of information between cells and their environment. And we'll be studying, we'll be talking about this in details in due course of time. As I told you yesterday, that biological membrane, cell surface, it is full of, it is all inundated with specific receptors. So let's say this is the cell surface, this is the cell, and this is the biological membrane. So on the surface all over, you will have stimuli, you will have receptors all over the surface. For example, all of you must have seen in a big apartment building, you know, where you have 20, 30, 40 flats, you'll find on the roof, you have those antennas for the television channels. Okay. So something like that, you have receptors spread all over the cell membrane. And what do? These receptors are specific. They are for external stimuli. So they will, you know, the stimuli will bind here and it will be communicated within the cell. Some membranes, they generate specific electrical or chemical signals. So for example, very simple example for where a membrane generates electrical signal is the nerve cell membrane. Nerve impulse is nothing but an electrical signal. So membranes generate specific electrical signal also. These membranes, they also are the, what you can say, they provide surface for the components of two important energy transducing processes or devices within the cell. And what are those two important energy transducing processes or devices? In case of plant cell, you have photosynthesis, okay, where solar energy is converted into chemical bond energy. And in case of animal cell, you have only one, that is oxidative phosphorylation, which takes place in the mitochondria. Okay, it takes place in mitochondria and plant cell also. So in plant cells, you have two energy transducing devices, whereas in case of animal cells, you have only one energy transducing device. So in case of photosynthesis, which takes place in chloroplast present in plant cell, okay, those energy transducing devices, the components of those energy transducing devices, that means photosynthesis, they are all located on the membrane of the chloroplast cell. Okay, thylakoid membranes within the chloroplast, they are located. Okay, and what do? They help trap the solar energy and convert it into chemical bond energy. So that is the only source of energy for all of us, solar energy. But only plants are capable of converting it into something which we can utilize. Similarly, in case of mitochondria, where oxidative phosphorylation takes place, what happens? Whatever is stored in chemical bond energy, that is converted into energy currency, that is ATP, through which, you know, all the transactions within the cell, within your body can take place. So ATP is the energy currency which is generated in the mitochondria. And these components of the oxidative phosphorylation, they are also located on the mitochondrial membrane. So biological membranes are, or they provide surface for the components of energy transducing machines, energy transducing devices or processes, photosynthesis and oxidative phosphorylation. Now, because you have a lot of diversity as far as eukaryotic cells are concerned, so one can find a lot of diversity in biological membranes of those cells also. So there exists a lot of diversity in the structure and function of biological membranes. So you can imagine, obviously also, because of the diversity that is there in the different types of cells, the types of cells which are present in eukaryotic cell, one can expect a lot of diversity in the structure and function of biological membranes. However, in spite of this, all of them show some common features. Okay, there are certain features which are common to all types of biological membranes. So what are those features? Let us see those features one by one. They are sheet-like structures. So I told you in the beginning itself that they are sheet-like structures, and their thickness is only a few molecules. Okay, they are only a few molecules thick. Please remember, their thickness is not very much. No, they are only a few molecules thick. And if you have to quantify what is the thickness of the membrane thickness ranges between 60 to 100 angstrom. 60 to 100 angstrom. Membrane thickness ranges between 60 to 100 angstrom, or you can say 6 to 10 nanometer. One nanometer is equal to 10 angstrom. So 6 to 10 nanometer, and you know 1 nanometer is equal to 10 angstrom also. 1 nanometer is equal to 10 to the power 9 meters. All right. So their thickness is very, very, small. There are only a few molecules thick. So if you have to quantify, you can remember this. Their thickness ranges between 60 to 100 angstrom units only. We said earlier, they are mainly made up of proteins and lipids. The two major components of all biological membranes is proteins and lipids. Proteins and lipids. And the ratio of the two, proteins and lipids, it ranges between 1:4 to 4:1. Means there are some membranes where proteins will be present one part and lipids will be present four parts. It is a range. So there will be some membranes where proteins will be present two parts and lipids will be present two parts. There will be membranes where proteins will be present three parts and lipids will be present one part. And there will be membranes where lipids are present four part and proteins are present one part. So there is a range. 1:4 to 4:1, depending upon the function of the cell, the composition of the biological membrane in terms of protein and lipid is determined. For example, the nerve cells, where insulation is required because they carry the nerve impulse, which is an electrical signal, insulation is required, and obviously in case of nerve cells, the lipid component is going to be very high. So the ratio in nerve cells, the lipid to protein ratio in nerve cells will be 4:1, four parts lipids and one part proteins, means close to 80% lipids and 20% protein. In mitochondrial cell, you know, which carry out oxidative phosphorylation, which contain components of energy transducing device, obviously protein has to be more. So in mitochondrial membranes, probably the ratio of proteins to lipid would be, there will be four parts of protein and one part of lipid. Okay, so depending upon what kind of function is being carried out by the biological by the cell, the composition of the biological membrane in that cell is going to be determined. Composition in terms of proteins and lipids, and the ratio ranges between 1:4 to 4:1. Biological membranes, they also contain some amount of carbohydrates, approximately 2 to 10%, maximum 10%. The range is 2 to 10%. Okay, so when carbohydrates, they are attached with protein, it is called as glycoprotein. And when the carbohydrates are attached with lipid, they are called as glycolipids. Now, membrane lipids, they are small molecules. They are amphipathic in nature. You understand what is meant by amphipathic? Amphipathic means they have both the hydrophobic end and the hydrophilic portion, hydrophilic part. So any molecule which contains both the components, hydrophobic and hydrophilic. Hydrophobic means water hating, and hydrophilic means water loving. So a molecule which is having both the components in the same molecule is called as an amphipathic molecule. So lipids are amphipathic in nature, and these lipids, they typically form a bilayer which serve as a barrier to the entry of polar molecules. So this is an example. This is the lipid bilayer. Okay, a typical lipid will be representing like this. This is the lipid molecule, one lipid molecule. This is polar head. This is the hydrophilic head. This is polar. Hydrophilic. And these tails, these are hydrophobic. There are a couple of them shown over here. So these are hydrophobic. Okay, means water hitting. And if you see the structure, what happens when they form a bilayer, this hydrophobic means water hitting. Those groups are shielded from water. And hydrophilic, these, you know, purple colored circles, they will be exposed. They will be facing the aqueous medium. They will be in touch with the aqueous medium because they are water loving. And they will be shielding their hydrophobic counterparts. So biological membranes, the lipid components in the biological membrane, they form this kind of bilayers, okay, made up of lipids. Okay, these lipids are oriented in such a way that the hydrophilic heads, they're exposed to the aqueous medium, and hydrophobic parts, they are shielded from the aqueous medium. What are the other features? Membrane proteins. You know, you have proteins also, as we said. So these membrane proteins are either loosely bound, shown over here. They are either loosely bound, the one in blue, they are loosely bound. And the one in yellow, these are membrane proteins. They are deeply embedded into the biological membrane. This is lipid bilayer. Okay. So proteins can be either loosely bound, as shown by these blue colored things, or they can be deeply embedded in the biological membranes. Okay, and what do? These proteins, lipids, they serve as a barrier, whereas membrane proteins, they perform all the dynamic functions of it. Whatever membrane functions are there, they are performed by the membrane proteins. And what are the functions? The functions are like this. They serve as channels, pumps, receptors. So channels, pumps, or receptors, all of them are going to be made up of proteins only. Membranes are non-covalent assemblies. Please remember, non-covalent assemblies. Membrane components, means lipids and proteins, they won't have any covalent bonds in between them. Rather, they are held together by a number of non-covalent bonds. So they are non-covalent assemblies. You won't find any covalent interaction between the two membrane lipids or between a membrane lipid and a membrane protein. Rather, they are held together by a number of non-covalent bonds. Similarly, they are asymmetric. All biological membranes are asymmetric in nature. What is meant by this? That means the two phases. This is phase one, FAC phase. And this is phase two of the biological membrane. So these two phases of biological membrane are never, please remember, never going to be same, never going to be identical. They are always going to be asymmetric in nature. The two phases of the membranes are never same. Okay, so you won't find the similar structures on both the faces. Okay, you will have some proteins attached randomly on the external face, extracellular face, some proteins attached randomly to the intracellular face. You will find lots of carbohydrate units attached to both lipids as well as proteins. These are carbohydrate units. Huh? But these carbohydrate units you will find only on the extracellular phase. You won't find carbohydrate in the intracellular. Normally you won't find. Generally carbohydrates are attached only to the extracellular phase. So because of this, the two faces of the membrane are never going to be identical. You will always find them different. And therefore we use the word that they're asymmetric. Membranes are asymmetric in nature. They are fluid mosaics. Means these membranes are dynamic structures. They are dynamic entities. They are not static. Dynamic ka matlab ye hota hai, they don't remain stagnant. Okay, these membrane lipids are very fluid. They can migrate in lateral plane like this. Membrane proteins can also migrate. Means the protein which is A shown over here, visible over here. Next moment, this A can be seen here, and the B can be seen here. In the next moment, the A can move to this place, and the C can move to this place, like this. Okay, so they can move laterally. That is what we meant by their dynamic structures. Both the components, membrane proteins and as well as membrane lipids, they can move in horizontal plane. Okay, they are dynamic structure. They are fluid structure. They are not static. Right, so they can move in lateral direction. However, vertical movement is rather limited or not allowed. This way movement is not allowed, but this way movement is allowed in horizontal plane. So that is why we say them as the fluid mosaics. They are not static structures, rather they are dynamic assemblies. Membrane lipids and proteins can move horizontally. Vertical movements, as I said, are either slow or it doesn't take place at all. Most biological membranes are electrically polarized, with inside being negative. Biological membrane jo hogi, they are polarized, means inside jo hai, you will find electric negative charge. And what is the potential? It is around 60 millivolts. Inside of the biological membrane, you will find more electronegative compared to the outside. So net charge is negative charge, and it is approximately 60 millivolts. So this is the structure, fluid mosaic structure, jo bolte hai na, Sanger and Nicholson ne jo propose kiya tha, ye fluid mosaic structure hai. So you can see over here what we discussed, that you know these are the lipid, the one in blue, this is the polar head, and these are the hydrophobic tails. So this is lipid bilayer, right? And the one in purple, or you can say you know light brown, these are proteins. Okay, so this one is a deeply embedded integral protein, we call it as deeply embedded protein. And these are peripheral proteins. These are loosely bound proteins, you can see. This is also loosely bound. This is not full, though it is embedded, but it's not fully embedded. So these are peripheral proteins. Okay, and what are these? The one in green, these are the oligosaccharide, carbohydrate units. When you have more than two, three, then we call them as oligosaccharide. So this is the extracellular phase. As I told you, you will find this carbohydrate unit only on the extracellular phase. You won't find in the cytoplasmic phase. These are the two phases of the biological membrane. Okay, so you won't find carbohydrate here. You don't see carbohydrate here. Carbohydrate units, if they are there at all, they are going to be there on the extracellular phase, right? And carbohydrates can be attached to protein. So when they are attached to protein, we call them as glycoprotein. So for example, here it is attached to protein, so you call it as glycoprotein. And they can be attached to lipid also. So for example, here, so you call them as glycolipid. You call it as glycolipid, right? So the proteins which are deeply embedded are called as integral proteins. And the proteins which are loosely bound, they are called as peripheral proteins. Right? So this is a typical fluid mosaic model. And lipids and proteins, they are free to move in the horizontal plane. They move horizontally, horizontal plane like this. But vertical movement, this particular movement is not allowed. Okay, so something which is visible to you here at as of now, after some time, if you see biological membrane again, you will find that it has migrated to this place. This protein has migrated to this place, like this. So that is what is meant by that they are dynamic assemblies, they are dynamic structures. What are the components of the biological membrane? So I told you there are major components being lipids and proteins. These are called as major components. Okay, and I told you the ratio ranges between 1:4 to 4:1. And this ratio depends on what? This ratio depends on what kind of function that particular cell is carrying out. For example, nerve cell, you will find very high ratio of lipid to protein. Okay, lipid will be much higher and protein will be less because insulation is required. Whereas in case of mitochondrial membranes, you will find the opposite. Means there will be more proteins and there will be less lipid. And other cell, depending upon their function, will be somewhere in between. So most of the cells will have ratio 1:1. That means 50% protein approximately, 50% lipids. Carbohydrates are also present, but they are present only as a minor component. I told you that their concentration, their composition ranges between 2 to 10%. Right? And carbohydrates can be attached to both lipids and protein. When they are attached to lipid, we call it as glycolipid. And when they are attached to protein, we call it as glycoprotein. Right? Let us understand one by one these components. We'll start with membrane lipids. So membrane lipids, what are lipids in the first place? These lipids, you must have studied in your BSc also. They're a group of biomolecules, rather a major group of biomolecules. It's one of the major groups of biomolecules. And they're typically insoluble in water, but they're soluble in organic solvents. Acetone, chloroform, even ethanol, all these organic solvents, they're soluble. What do? Their major function, they serve a variety of biological roles. For example, they serve as fuel molecules. As and when needed, they can be mobilized and they can be catabolized to provide you energy. They serve as a concentrated stores of energy. So additional energy, suppose if your requirement is 2000 kilocalories and whatever you are eating generates about 2500 kilocalories. So that additional 500 kilocalories in your body is deposited in the form of fats, adipose tissues. Because 1 gram of fat can give you 9 kilocalories of energy. So they serve as concentrated stores of energy. You have a very limited storage capacity of carbohydrates. Okay, but a lot of fats can be stored in your body. Now we have seen that they serve as components of the membrane, biological membrane. Okay, they are rather a major component of the biological membrane, and they also serve as signal molecules. So these are some of the major functions of the lipids. Okay, one of the components of the membrane. And what are the different types of lipids which are present? So you have 3 major types of lipids present in the biological membrane. The major category, the most common being phospholipids. Probably you must have studied it in your BSc also, but we'll be repeating it once again. The second major category is glycolipids, and the third major category is cholesterol. All these 3 are present in the biological membrane. So you have phospholipids, the most abundant lipid class in the biological membrane. You have glycolipids and you have cholesterol.